One of my recipients was on a mission helping his wife and was not in the room during my presentations. I am now presenting the Massachusetts Proclamation to Archie Gooding, Rolling Thunder, Chapter 7. Thank you, everyone, for your patience, and now we can go on with the program.
Mike Jokas.
Thank you so much. I'm chairman of the information office, but I'm a state representative representing this district.
Okay. Georgia.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'd like to introduce State Representative Mike Jokas with a special proclamation presentation.
Thank you. Good morning. I am the state representative for this area. My district is District 138, and to the east I'm bordered with Andersonville, and to the west I'm bordered with Fort Benning. So this is definitely a military district, one that I'm very, very proud of. One of the things that makes this thing so important to me for what y'all do, and I wanted to share a personal note with you, is my dad served in the Army Air Corps during the Second World War. He was a right waist gun on a B-17. And fortunately, rather it was unfortunate he got shot down, but it was fortunate that the underground, the Belgium underground, picked him up and his crew and shipped him back to England. And within 2 days, he was back on planes dropping bombs over Germany. We were fortunate in the fact that he was rescued and able to come back. We appreciate your service, your sacrifice. As I was walking around the room talking with different friends, I don't mind telling you, it brings me goosebumps to be amongst you great heroes. And let me say that again, y'all are all heroes. Not only the men and women that served, but the family members that sacrificed. And for that, personally, I am forever grateful. Oops, I'm sorry. And as representing the state of Georgia, we in the state of Georgia are grateful for your sacrifice and service. I've got a proclamation that I'd like to present on behalf of Governor Dathan Deal, the governor of the state of Georgia, and if you would bear with me, I'd like to read it. By the governor of the state of Georgia, proclamation, POW-MIA Recognition Day. The state of Georgia will forever owe a lasting debt of gratitude to its sons and daughters who have honorably and valiantly served in our nation's military to defend the lives, liberty, and democracy of not only Americans, but also other nations, often risking and many giving their lives on the battlefield. According to the national and state historical data, from the Revolutionary War to present, over 18,800 Georgians have been held as prisoners of war, for more than 2,630 having died in captivity, and over 1,400 still unaccounted for. A national POW-MIA Recognition Day, we recognize with deep respect the brave Americans who were held in captivity and those whose fates have never been resolved, remembering that their families continue to suffer. In defending American ideals, let us remember these Georgians who were prisoners of war and suffered the indignities and brutality of captivity. We must never forget the profound and painful suffering of Georgia families who continue to await word about the recovery of loved ones still unaccounted for and considered missing in action. On Friday, September 19th, 2014, we pause to remember all former American prisoners of war who suffered the hardships of enemy captivity, as well as all Americans still listed as missing in action and whose fate is still undetermined. I, Nathan Deal, Governor of the State of Georgia, do hereby proclaim September 19, 2014 as POW-MIA Recognition Day in Georgia, urging all citizens to observe with appropriate ceremonies, recognition, moments of silence, the sacrifices of those who were held as prisoners of war, as well as those who remain missing in action, and to further encourage our citizens to fly the POW-MIA flag as a tribute. It is witnessed, therefore, I have unto set my hand and cause seal of the executive department to be affixed on the 11th day of September in the year of our Lord, 2014, the Honorable Governor Nathan Deal. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your service. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for remembering.
Thank you, Representative Chokas. We appreciate that very much. I want to welcome everybody this morning to the ride homes honoring their sacrifice service. We appreciate everybody being here this morning. I know that the last couple of days get a little long, but it's good that we got a little extra sleep this morning. Little. At this time, I'd like to introduce our good friend Dave Reeve again, who's going to do the history of the flag.
I walked through the county courthouse square on a park bench, an old man was sitting there. I said, the old courthouse is kind of run down. He said, no, it'll do for our little town. I said, the old flagpole is leaning a little bit, and that's a ragged old flag you got hanging on it. He said, have a seat. And I said, have. Is this the first time you've been to our little town? I said, I think it is. You see, we got a little hole in that flag there when Washington took it across the Delaware. And it got powder burned the night that Francis Scott Key said Washington's right and safe in the sea. And it got a bad rip in New Orleans when Packenham and Jackson took it at the sea. And it almost fell at the Alamo beside the Texas. She got cut with a sword at Chancellorsville, and she got cut again at Shiloh Hill. There was Robin E. Lee, Beauregard, and Bragg, and the south wind blew hard on that ragged old flag. On Flanders Field in World War I, she got a big hole from a burglar gun. She turned blood red in World War II. She hung limp and low. She was sent to Korea, Vietnam. She went where she was sent by her Uncle Sam. She waved from our ships upon the briny foam, and now they've about quit with me back here at home. In her own good land, she's been abused. She's been burned, dishonored, denied, and abused. And the government for which she stands is easy to make a whole lot more. So we raise her up every morning, we take it down every night, we don't let her touch the ground, and we hold her upright. On second thought, I do like to brag, because I'm mighty proud.
But how many Americans can actually go downtown square and sit and look at the memorials and the flags that are flying? And tell a stranger about the history of our flag. Because it is what's more than a flag. Every one of you sitting in this room are part of the fabric and history of that flag. And that, I thank you. Because you allowed me, and I was born in 1962, to grow up in a country where I consider myself free. And I too served 21 years. So my little daughter will be able to grow up into a country and she should say she's free. The flag. There was a POW, and I always say his name wrong, John Damaris is how I call him, from 1967 to 73 for the POW. Him and a fellow prisoner had escaped. And about 3 days later, they were caught. And of course, the punishment for escaping was pretty severe. 30 days of consecutive punishment they received. His friend never survived. And he was sent back to his cell, battered and bruised. But in the corner of his cell, the one thing they could not destroy was his spirit, his American spirit. He took the fabric, red fabric from another prisoner's underwear. He took the red and white thread in the handkerchief of a mother that had sent a care package to one of her sons. He got the gold from a blanket. He got the blue from a sweater. And what he used as a needle was a little piece of copper he found in a compound. And in the corner of his cell, he made contraband. He had made an American flag. When he was released, he presented that flag to the President of the United States. And he said, as I held the flag high, I thought of this country and the part that we played in defending its greatest attribute, freedom. In defense of freedom, let us continue to do as we're expected to do, but what must be endured will be endured. We cannot take our freedoms for granted. Because in that cell, they had the whispers of freedom. They had the whispers of freedom. Riverside, California, the flag folding ceremony I performed over 250 times. And at the American, the VFW, the Marine Corps League performs, now cannot be done in national cemeteries. Because some words in him offended somebody. The POW table at Patrick Air Force Base, just this year, was removed from the dining facility. Why? Because the Bible offended somebody. Everybody remembers Red Skeleton's talk about what the Pledge of Allegiance meant to him. And he said, wouldn't it be a shame if they took it from the schools because they considered it a crime? Slowly, Americans, if we do not understand the history of our country and our flag, we too one day may wake up and the flag has offended too many people and can no longer be flown in public. We shake our head no. But those things I just talked about are reality already. was a man that had walked into Capitol Building and filled it. And when he looked up in the dome, perfect building for it, he saw all these flags hanging in the Capitol Dome. And he said, "Flags, flags. Nothing but flags. Tattered, torn, hanging in rags. And we walk beneath them with such careless tread, nor think that the host was the mighty ghost that once marched beneath them on days gone by." Well, today, folks, hold on to your chair, because I'm going to turn the 45-minute ceremony into a real quick ceremony. Because we're going to remember those men that marched beneath those flags and made the country of what we serve and honor and are taken for granted today preserved for us. 1775. The king was sending the troops to go arrest Samuel Jackson and John Hancock. 150 men and Captain Parker stood across the bridge of the mightiest army there was in the world. And Captain Parker said, "If war is what they want, let it begin here." And the first shot that was heard around the world started a revolution. All these men on a rebellion to be free, an independent country, how silly. Well, they selected George Washington to be our commander-in-chief of the Continental Army. We couldn't even arm an army. We had no weapons. So what did we do? We built six ships. Remember, we couldn't have weapons, couldn't have a navy. Built them in secret. Those six ships sailed down to the Bahamas with the pine tree flag. Had a white flag and a pine tree. The philosophy behind that was the men used to always form up behind underneath a tree in the town square. You're out in Oklahoma and there's no trees, they put a pole, okay? So that's what they were saying. But the key thing, and they talk about and whisper about freedom, independence. So the pine tree flag. But there was another flag that was on those ships. Colonel Gaston, the Gaston flag. I just had to go to the town hall Tuesday. The mayor had asked me to come down because a man had the Gaston flag flying on his business and they were going to threaten to fine him $250 a day until he takes that flag down. That is American flag history, battle flag. Because when the men came off that ship underneath this flag and captured the British weapons at the Bahamas, if you follow those boys through time, they later became the United States Marine Corps. The Gaston flag. The rattlesnake. Benjamin Franklin used to write about it in Farmer's Almanac. The king would always send the criminals to America. And he said, "Why don't we just put a bunch of rattlesnakes in a bag and send them to the king?" But he said, "The rattlesnake, you leave it alone, it'll leave you alone. You poke at it, it's got a deadly strike. And on the tail of the rattlesnake, coiled up ready to strike, because we were tired of being taxed to death and not having a word and being ruled by a king across the ocean. And it had 13 rattles on it." That's a good rattle. My dad used to bring it to me when he went dove down in Arizona for the 13th digital conference. Amen. Don't tread on it. The Gaston flag. Well, we stole our weapons, so now we can outfit General George Washington's army. So when General George Washington rode into town, he had his hand-picked lifeguard flying his flag. All generals have a flag, don't they? The general's flag. I don't know if the lower guys have any other flags. This was George Washington's flag. So his lifeguard came riding in. He saw his troops all outfitted in a uniform and weapons. And as his team halted, he looked up and he saw the first flag that his army was going to fight under. the Grand Union flag. Come on down. Do you step? I appreciate these volunteers this morning. They all stepped up and said, hey, heard you need somebody to carry some flags. We'll carry it. And they're filling in. Just like any military operation, there's flexibility built in the plan. They're working right along here. These two flags. So George Washington's there. He accepts his army under the Grand Union flag. Now, you got to use your imagination, crowd. I want you to take the white stripes off this flag. So now you got a red flag with the king's colors in the upper left-hand corner, right? Everybody knows what that flag is, right? Just like my bank account. When I got married, my wife made me put her name on it. Well, when the queen took over, Queen Anne did away with the king's colors and came up with her own flag. This is called the Queen Anne flag. She colonized the America with this flag. So what did we do? We just put some white stripes on the Queen Anne flag and called it the Grand Union flag. It sent a message to the king. 13 colonists. We would love to be united with you and solve this in a peaceful manner. But if war is what it's going to take, war is what it's going to take when you want to be set. Grand Union flag. Thank you, gentlemen. My wife says, I don't know why you white stripes because you have a follow-up. Oh, we're not done yet, though. Government said, okay, we're going to have a flag. All right? Resolved, we're going to have 13 red and white alternating stripes. It's going to have 13 stars, white stars in a blue field, and make the flag. Well, old Molly Stark made Colonel Stark the flag. Colonel Stark was getting ready for the Battle of Benedict, and she wasn't going to have her man go to battle with no flag. This is called the Benedict flag. Probably one of the most correct flags that you probably fly yet. See how good we work together, but you just kept that kind of thing. You notice Molly put white stripes at the top. Because the flag rule said, if the flag has stripes, it's got to begin and it's got to end in white. Two red arrows, didn't you? And also, how many points are on the stars? According to the rules, a star has 6 or more points. 7. All right, if you know our history now a little bit there, you stay right here. So Colonel Stark is facing off over 600 German mercenaries in the bridge. And he made a quote to his men. He said, my men yonder are the Haitians. They were brought for 7 pounds and 10 pence a man. Are you worth more? Of course, you know all his men were doing this, right? Pay raise is coming along. He said, true. Because tonight, the American flag floats over yonder hill, where Molly Stark sweeps the widow tonight. So Colonel Stark's battling, and he's losing. And he's losing bad. Until all of a sudden, they saw something come up over the ridge. It was another flag. And who was this? Mo, the ride home, Roman Thunder? No, they're here today for you, though. Ethan Allen, Green Mountain Boys. See, Vermont, when the Revolution broke out, they wanted to be their own country. They didn't want to be part of it. They formed their own army, going to be their own flag and everything. And who said the South was the first to secede, all right? So, I'm a Virginia boy. Here's Elvin Craig. Those boys were pretty smart. A green flag running through the heels up to the Virginians and the Vermont and all those areas. But how many points are on the stars? Anything less than 6 points is a row or a spur. Well, he's got 13 spurs arriving on his flag. All right. What do they always say about the American flag? It's a little arrogant, right? We figure we're starting our own country. We're going to set our own rules. How many points a star has? There we go. Set straight. Thank you. Ethan Allen and Colonel Stark. Ethan Allen actually was caught shortly after that battle and was shipped to England as a POW, and then he was released after the Revolution. One of the worst battles of the Revolution, and they say probably one of the ugliest flags created. The Guilford Courthouse flag. Oh, disregard. Yep, Guilford Courthouse flag. Remember the resolution said, red and white stripes alternating. White stars on a blue field. Somebody was squeaking. Now I'm going to have this mistake. Well, every human being had six or more points. They could have been colorblind, or they just didn't listen, but I'm thinking there was two congressmen or senators talking during the resolution. You're going to see this in a second. You said it was one of the worst battles of the resolution. Guilty Courthouse. We lost. But they put such a hurt on Cornwallis, he had no real fight left in him after that point. And everyone's view was the downfall of him surrendering to George Washington. But sometimes you can't lose a fight and still win the war. Now, I haven't forgot about the Navy boys yet. All right? John Clark. My next flag, the surface flag. The Navy, I would just like to say. John Paul Jones captured the British ship. They fought for hours and hours and hours. The ship was hit right on the side where it was taking water. And that's when they were asking if he was ready to surrender. And he said his famous words, "I have yet begun to fight." And he sailed when he could to his ship. Put it up next to the British ship, and they captured it, took them all prisoners, so now they're sailing a ship with no flag, because his bond home flag went down with his ship. Well, when he came into a Dutch port, the textile, they're repairing the ship, and they said, "Hey, Benjamin Franklin, the ambassador for France, had described what your new flag looked like, and we will make it for you." And John Paul Jones sailed back to the United States with the flag of the United States. Now I'm going to tell you, weren't these two talking when they put out the resolution? I guarantee you that there was history taking them sit beside each other. But you know the key thing? They didn't have to do that. They didn't have a phone. They got out by word of mouth. They made these flags. These were all battle flags. They fought battle. They represented what we were going to be. Thank you very much. Well, the time we came down, we got to make a flag. There's a little confusion at who made the first flag. Is it Betsy Ross? Is it Betsy Ross or Mr. Hodgkins? Now, the early flags by Mr. Hodgkins and Betsy Ross were said to be like General George Washington's flag. You notice that he had his stars in a straight row? Well, none of the early flags actually survived. This is one of the most popular flags recognized as the first flag in the United States of America by Betsy Ross. And how did they come to that? Well, just like my wife, she says, save your receipts. Because Francis Hopkins didn't have a receipt that he had never paid for his flags. Betsy said, I got mine. Now give me my refund. I work at Walmart, so I don't know what that means. So, the Betsy Ross flag. So now we got continuity. We know what our flag is going to look like. You notice they went to the red first. Because they said when you're out to sea, you can't see the first stripe or the last stripe because it just blends into the sky. And remember that if you read the little history, Betsy Ross would sit there with her scissors and a piece of paper and cut a perfect star every time, all sizes. And she said women are putting 6, 7, 8 points on stars. Let's get some consistency. So we redefine the definition of a star on a flag. It's 5 pounds. Thank you. Now we have the War of 1812. King George was still upset. He's like, no way these guys are going to be an independent country and push my army around, the mightiest army in the world. So they started gathering men. Washington was already in flames. They were getting ready to go after Baltimore. Who's from Maryland here? I know I saw some Maryland patches on some vests. There goes the band. Everybody goes. Fort McHenry is coming up next. Now, if there was a war today, I guarantee every one of you would stand up, and I know I would stand up, to go serve our country today. And then the government starts coming down with standards. Oh, I'm sorry, you're too old. No, you can't run. They started having qualification standards. So a lot of our revolution guys were disqualified. Well, the heck with that. So they formed their own group called the Veterans Exempt. And they fought under this flag, the Veterans Exempt flag, and they actually accepted the white flag of surrender from the British at the Michigan Lakes. A lot of people say that it looks like the ISIS flag. Well, no, the ISIS flag looks a lot like the Veterans Exempt flag, but we had it first. All right. Pretty neat flag. Just a little part of history. We got a member that's in our chapter. He can't join us because he just never qualified to serve in the service. He was disqualified. He said, I found my flag. I'm a member of the Veterans Exempt. Now I can go fight. They're pretty neat. Our next flag. Thank you. Soon our country grew to 15 states. 15 stars, 15 stripes on a flag. One of the largest flags made was flying at Fort McHenry. The British, the only thing that stood between them and Baltimore was Fort McHenry. You had a whole Navy fleet out there. And they said, when you take that flag down, we'll know you surrender. And of course, you know us Americans, the flag's not coming down. So for a solid day, they bombed and bombed and bombed Fort McHenry. Their objective is to take that flag down. And the rest of it is in the history books. Because in the morning, there was POWs on those ships out there. And there was a young lawyer out there trying to negotiate their release. And as he watched the bomb bursting in the air, and it came morning and there was so much smoke and fog, the young man was trying to see if he could see the flag. And the prisoners down in the hall was like, is the flag still there? Is the flag still there? And straining, swiping to the side. And he told the boys, the flag is still there, and they're all in cheering. They didn't care about their releases. They wanted to know if the flag was still there. And then he jotted those words down on an envelope. The Star-Spangled Banner. Francis Scott. What was that? That's when that became known as the Star Spangled Banner. It was also the last flag to have more than 13 stripes. Thank you. One of the part of the books they don't have in history, when Francis Scott Key came to the shore, he saw what held that flag up. Every time that flag was hit, the men would throw their weapons to the side and hold that pole. And that's what we hope that we have each flag. Body of Jesus. The hell of a sit on the bench and tell somebody that. It's more than just that. It is the symbol of this country. Sir, in the country, we had 20 states. And they have a new resolution. We will have 13 alternating red and white stripes. We can't have 20 stripes, 50 stripes, so they set it at 13 stripes. There will be a new star added for each new state. The 20-star flag, one of the first flags to fly at school. And a lot of the early flags were called the Great Star Flag. They put them in a star formation. Various different angles, different styles. The 20-star flag. The Great Star Flag. The Seminole War was going on at the time down in Florida. Thank you. Next flag. Soon, the South woke up to a new flag one day. Bring the bars and start. 7 states seceded from the Union to form their own country. If you were in one of those southern states, eventually 11 states seceded from the Union. This would have been your first Confederate flag, better known as the Bars and Stars. Remember Johnny Cash said, the South blew hard. She did. Next flag came down beside her. The 35-star flag. It's known as the flag that restored the Union. Abraham Lincoln was constantly battered to remove the stars from the flag in each state that seceded from the Union. He said the stars were not on the flag. Our brothers were just confused. He kept them on. When our Civil War ended, there was 2 other flags after this one for the Confederacy. And when the flag came down over in Richmond, the capital, the 35-star flag flew into place. The Union restored. Those 2 flags go together. This is.
Amen.
Thank you. The 48-star flag. Bring that flag down and I'll make a stand. They said, Dave, man, there's a flag that if we don't have it, we're going to talk about that. That's what they were thinking about. 48-star. Most of you men called under the 48-star. 48-star started World War I. When Colonel Stanton came into France in 1917, he went to the tomb of Lafayette. He said, we're here. I see Lafayette sacrificed much for our revolution to help us in the battle against Britain. We were just returning the favor. World War II, the 48 star flag. The 48 star flag that flew on the Capitol on December the 7th when Pearl Harbor was attacked became a special flag. That same flag flew the next day when he declared war on Japan. That same flag was raised again 3 days later when he declared a war on Germany and Japan, or Italy. That same flag flew atop of the USS Missouri when it surrendered to Japanese. The 48 star flag saw a forgotten war in Korea. The 48 star and the 50 star were born in the jungle of Vietnam. Other than our current flight is the longest living war. And it saw a lot of bloodshed. But that flag was respected around the world. In World War II, when the Americans came in to lead, to free the people in that town, the women had all been making American flags. And if you got caught with one, it was instant death. So they hid them. And when the Americans were coming down, along with the Belgian resistance forces, and the Germans were running out of town, the ladies would throw those flags out the window and yell and cheer right in front of their face. They understand what freedom means. They understand what that flag means. Thank you. Our current flag sits upon the moon. Saw a whole change in America. And currently, all the conflicts up to our current time. A lot of people call her Old Glory. You don't need to stand there. Gentlemen, you guys serve that flag. We're here to honor you. Because without you, we wouldn't have this flag today. When I tell this story, I'm telling your story. Because you're the fabric. That's why we should never forget them. Because when we forget them, you forget that. And they can't take that away from me. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, the flag of the United States of America and the men and women that made it what it is today.
What a wonderful history of our American flag and our country. At this point, if you would all rise for presentation of the colors by Light Horse Explorers, Post 106. The flag was presented earlier. We're going to move on to Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. You may be seated. This time, we'll have our invocation from the Dr. Reverend Chuck Gass.
Will you join me in a moment of silence for all those who are in this very moment in harm's way? A moment of silence to honor the families who sent their loved ones into harm's way. A moment of silence for those who will not return home. A moment of silence to press into our hearts for those who returned and left blood and a piece of their soul in a foreign land. Lord, hear your servant's voice. We humbly petition you to pour your Holy Spirit upon this place. Please, God, let us feel your presence during these ceremonies that now come. Empower us as servants to honor these, our guests, with the dignity, respect, admiration, and love that each has earned by the stripes they carry. Let us create here a memory for our POWs, their families, the Gold Star mothers and the families of the MIAs, a memory that will go with them through the coming months. As well, may our words and deeds enrich your kingdom here on earth. Until they all come home, let us say together as a people, amen.
Thank you, Dr. Gass. A part of the missing in action paradigm that we live with and that continues is accounting for those who are missing and doing proper identification of those who are brought home. This morning, I'd like to present Major Alexander J. Vanston. We've heard from him before. Commanding Officer of Headquarters Company East, Marine Corps Logistics Command, to talk about his experiences with JPAC and the accounting effort. Major Vanston.
Well, good morning, and I'd like to start by thanking you for allowing me to speak here again this year. It's truly an honor to be here among those of you that have sacrificed so much. From 2006 to 2008, or 2009, I'm sorry, I had the opportunity and the honor to be recovery team leader at JPAC. And I'd like to assure you that, regardless of the politics, there are about 150 of our brothers and sisters in arms, and they're working as hard as they can every day to make sure that the Central Identification Laboratory is completely full and as busy as possible identifying our missing in actions. What I'm going to do this year, a little bit different than last year, is take you through some pictures of the recoveries and just talk to some of the slides rather than give you all the background on the Central Identification Lab and the JPAC mission. Next slide, please. Slide. All right. This is a Mok Chau, Vietnam. This was an F-4 crash. And what you see here is what we would go into any mission with, which was a site survey done. Just kind of laying the ground rule of where we're gonna, what we're gonna excavate. You'll see in the next picture here, I was the sixth team to go to the site to try and find the remains of the two pilots, or at least prove that they were in the aircraft when it actually impacted the ground. Down here and on the other side of this road were previous recovery efforts, and this is what we intended to do during the mission that I led there. Next slide, please. All right, as you can see, it was a tea plantation. Down here was where the other recovery efforts had been done. And it might be hard to see, but we've masked out and taped out where we're going to remove the tea plants before we start the excavation. Slide. This is just a shot of it after the tea plants have been removed, what we plan on excavating. And if you kind of see down here, you'll see some different types of plants that they were planted in the area where the tea plants had been removed from the previous excavations at the site. Slide. All right, now we're going to go to Laos. And I'm going to show you what a typical rice paddy during the dry season might look like. And you'll notice this ridge here between the rice paddies. We went here. It was a site of a prisoner of war camp looking for some isolated burials. And to find the site, we were basically trying to locate some test trenches that had been dug by a team that had gone there about 12 years prior. Next slide. This is that same site from the air. There's that ridge I pointed out earlier. And here you can see the test trenches that we found. The interesting thing that you learn with JPAC is that you can't dig a hole in the soil without leaving a mark for a long time. It disturbs the natural strata of the soil. And what we would do is dig until we found undisturbed soil. So as we were digging, you could tell along these areas, the soil was a different color. Those were the test trenches. So we use this as a point of reference to do the rest of the excavations throughout the area. Slide. Now this is what you call working harder, not smarter. It was the dry season, and we were literally picking and pounding the dirt apart until the idea dawned on me to buy a pump and flood the rice paddies, because they're already there to hold water, let them sit for a couple days and be able to make it a whole lot easier. Slide. Typical screening operation. Everything that we do at a JPEC mission, all the dirt we pull is going to go to a screening station like this. It'll be in Southeast Asia, we'll hire a lot of local nationals to work the screens. They'll sit there and just basically massage the dirt through the screens with their hands. But before they flip it, and you can see there's American there, American there, American there, one of the JPEC team members would have to come look at the screen, look at the rocks that were in there and everything, and then they'd allow them to turn the rocks over and then start the next bucket of dirt. Slide. All right, this is Dr. Greg Fox. He's one of the anthropologists at JPEC. What he's doing here is a soil survey. He's basically drawing the different layers in the soil on this wall here that you can't see, just for documented evidence. Everything that we would do, you know, there'd be site sketches that the anthropologist would do. And really the driving force behind the recovery. Myself, as the team leader, I'm more of the logistician, the plans, get the team there, make sure everything's there. But once we get on the site, I dig in the hole like everybody else, and he runs the show, the anthropologists that are there. Slide. It's kind of difficult to see here, but this is that same area. This is one of the areas that we excavated these different rice paddies. One of the old, what would have been an irrigation trench, and over time, the paddies changed shape. They moved dirt, and so we found that. Next slide. Koh Tang, Cambodia. Many of you will remember this story better than I can tell it. The raid on Koh Tang started the morning of May 15, 1775. And it started off bad. The raid had been delayed due to some bureaucracy in Washington, D.C. And by the time the CH-53s that the Air Force was flying, carrying the Marines onto the island, came in, the sun was already too high to mask their approach. Bad intelligence, wrong assumptions, led to a landing on the island that the Mayaguez hostages were not on, and that was not inhabited by light resistance of 10 to 20, maybe 30 Koh Tang soldiers, or I'm sorry, Khmer Rouge soldiers, but a battery of them. Knife 31 and 32 were shot down as they approached the island off of this coast right here. And for the next 14 hours, 15 U.S. service members were killed in action. We suffered about 50 injured. The mission turned from a rescue operation quickly to a seize these two beachheads, hold them till night, when we can extract. still unaccounted for on that island, is Lance Corporal Ashton Lonely. He was left in a body bag during the night evacuation on this beach here. Air Force Staff Sergeant Elwood Rambaugh. He was not recovered during a previous JPAC excavation to this island that recovered a lot of the remains off of this coast where most of the helicopters were shot down. And three Marines that were left behind last known alive, PFC Gary Hall, Lance Corporal Joseph Hargrove, and Private Danny Marshall. Next slide. As usual in Southeast Asia, we had a lot of local nationals. In this case, Koh Tang Island is just a military outpost for Cambodia. So we had all the soldiers on the island that were helping us do the recovery there. Slide. Next slide. This is another shot of that beach where we were looking for Lowry, where his body was left. Again, you can see that what we're doing is digging in grids, starting a new grid right here, the bucket line that would go to the screening station. And by the end of this recovery effort, we cleared out this area. This screening station is probably about 30 feet in the air because, of course, the dirt piles up, you pull up on the bamboo, and you just keep going higher and higher. Next slide. Just another angle of that same recovery. There's always at least one American in the hole as we're doing the recovery operation. Normally the anthropologist will be there, in this case there. And then again, the rest of the Americans on the screens. And we would take turns rotating through those positions. Slide. Here's an isolated burial site that was identified to us that possibly an American was buried in this area. And what we went out and went about a shovel deep, dug to what we call sterile soil. This is actually, as you can see, there's a big crowd of people there that we had a tour from the War College came in and was showing them this. So this is a couple days after we had closed the site. But you know, at the time, it would have been swept completely clean of all the debris to make sure that there's no more disturbances in the soil anywhere, that we know there's nothing deeper than that. You know, there's no additional reason to dig deeper because there was absolutely no disturbance in the soil. Next slide. And this is what made this mission very memorable to me, is many of you may have read it or know of it. There's a book out there called The Last Battle, The Mayaguez Incident and the End of the Vietnam War. And that's Ralph Wedehan, the author of that book. Here you have Kerry Turner. He's Joseph Hargrove's cousin. One morning we flew out to the island, landed on the island, and there's a little boat docked off the island. And they're there waiting for us. As you can imagine with JPAC, anytime a family member shows up without it being planned, it's a big deal. So there was lots of bells and whistles going on back in Honolulu, the fact that we had essentially press and a family member on a recovery site. However, to me, any family member that's going to travel across the world just to kind of see what's going on deserves a chance to work a little bit. So no time at all, we had Kerry in the hall digging. Not technically 100% allowed, but I think he earned it going out there. He spent about a week with us just observing what we were doing before he had to leave to go back. And the sites that you have family members on are always the best ones because it makes the connection for you. It really brings it home what you're doing and why you're out there doing it. Next slide. All right, Vasnach, Austria. I did quite a few recovery missions in Europe. And this was one of the more memorable, again, because I had a family member come out. That right there is Stanley Dwyer. He was piloting a B-17 when it was shot down on May 10th, 1944. He and his crew were on a bombing run to Wiener Neustadt, which was an aircraft, I believe it was a Messerschmitt facility, when his B-17 was struck by flak, caught fire, and they were forced to turn around. As they were trying to get back to the UK, four enemy fighters found them, began strafing runs on them, and decimated the aircraft. Stanley Dwyer decided not to jump out of the aircraft. His co-pilot, radio man, and the three gunners all reported that he had decided that he was going to try and belly land the aircraft fully loaded rather than drop the bombs on the small village of Vosnack that they were going over at the time. Eyewitnesses from the ground reported that he had lined up for his final approach on the open field, and as he was clearing a final hill, the aircraft stalled. The B-17 impacted the hill about 80 feet below the summit and exploded tremendously. The impact crater there is still visible today. Next slide, please. And here you have Stanley's younger brother, Howard Dwyer. Howard was a B-17 pilot over Italy the time his brother was shot down. Next slide. Him and his daughter, Kay Hughes, spent 2 weeks on the recovery site with us, and again, I put them to work. But Howard, being a B-17 pilot, wasn't just there as a family member, or not for me anyway. He was a wealth of knowledge as to what we were finding as we recovered pieces of the aircraft. As you can imagine, working on a small fighter jet, you know when you see a gauge pretty much where it's going to come from. The vast majority of them are going to be in the cockpit. However, on a B-17, you've got crew all over it. You've got life support equipment all over it. It makes a big difference to know what you're finding. And when you got somebody that can look at a gauge and tell you, no, that was in the left wheel well, it made a big difference, because everything with a dial and a needle on it, to me, means cockpit. They were also vital in this recovery actually getting scheduled, because they had gone out there, Kay had gone out there multiple times on her own, trying to find the crash site, actually located it on her own, and that was one of the things to let it get that led it to being scheduled as a recovery mission. Kay has since written a book called Searching for Stanley, unfortunately that was the final mission. We were the second team to go to that site to try and find his remains, and we did not find any remains during that mission. That was the final mission there. We actually excavated an area around the bomb, impact crater, because the team had already done the impact crater, and unfortunately the site was closed without finding remains. Next slide. This is just another site, and it might be hard to see, but this is kind of one of the small areas that we did. In this area, because we were outside of the actual impact crater, we were looking for things that had exploded and then dropped. We were going down about 2 shovels deep, actually going around, you can't kind of see it, but going around the roots of the trees, trying not to kill the trees because it was a protected forest. And most of them actually managed to survive, though we did kill quite a few of them. And again, you can see it's swept clean. We're looking for, you know, any kind of impacts that might have gone deeper, actually getting underneath the trees, but we're unfortunately unable to find remains. Next slide. Next slide. All right, my last mission that I want to talk about was actually my first mission as a team leader, and an unusual one, because it was on U.S. soil. Ko'olau Mountains of Hawaii, about 5 miles from JPAC headquarters. Ensign Harry Warnke, at age 23, succeeded in his dream of becoming a World War II Navy pilot. On the morning of June 15th, Harry Warnke was doing what he loved. He was flying his F-6 Hellcat on training bombing missions over Kaneohe Bay, Hawaii. As you can see by the clouds here, they roll in fast and quick over the Ko'olaus. As he entered the clouds to line up for his last dive for the day on Kaneohe Bay, the scars on Pearl Harbor would have still been visible over his left wing. His unit was heading out in another 3 days to fight the Japanese in the Pacific. He entered the clouds, and of course, he didn't come out the other side. His F-6 Hellcat impacted the mountains. And if you can see here, those are tarps that we would have over the site when we weren't there in the evenings to try and keep it dry from the rain so that we didn't lose anything to the wash. Next slide. The site was wet and muddy, very soft soil. Sometime after the impact and before the initial find of the site, most of the aircraft had been covered by a landslide. Because of that and because of the impact concerns, it actually took about 10 years for the environmental impact surveys to be done before we can go up and do before we can go up and do the recovery. We couldn't screen up there. There was no water source to use to do wet screening, as we would call it. So instead, we had to dig it by hand, put it in buckets, and carry it down the hill a ways to where we had a landing site set up. Next slide. So there we would put down cargo net, put down tarps, make 2,000 pound blocks of mud, wrap it all up. Next slide. And then we'd have, in this case, it was a Hawaii Air National Guard or contracted Hueys come in, pick up the package, and then take it to Schofield Barracks on the other side of the island. There, we'd spread the dirt out in tarps, allow it to dry, and then we could screen it through the screens like we normally would. Next slide. Here again, you can see how the weather goes from bad to worse there very quickly. We used to joke we'd be up there freezing, you know, about 45 degrees in the pouring rain, and about 6 miles away, people are laying in the sun in Waikiki. But here we have the Huey. That's about a 75-foot line. You can see the visibility drop off. And one of the hardest parts about that mission is we would have these stage packages up there ready to go, but we just couldn't get the aircraft in to get the dirt out. Next slide. Here's a picture of the entire tail section of the aircraft. You see the training wheel there. Right here are actually three of the barrels from the 50 cals, and one of the props right there, still visible. And as you can see, it's muddy. Next slide. This right here is we're getting ready to wrap up the site. That's the actual engine of the Hellcat. And at its deepest point, we were 17 and a half feet deep into the soil to get to that point. During the 65 days that we were up there, me and my seven-man team loaded and slung load out 206,000 pounds of soil in this recovery effort. Next slide. Thankfully, this one had a happy ending. Harry was laid to rest by his sister, Myrtle Tice, on June 20th, 2007, 62 years after his crash. What I'd like to say in closing is that JPAC and my missions with JPAC brought me all over the world to sites that were the scenes of tremendous violence. And today, without exception, they're all serene, peaceful, beautiful areas, whether they be tropical islands, wooded mountainsides, rural farms. Every site I worked on, I actually would sit down and think, especially when we weren't finding the individual, that this isn't a bad place to be. But in the end, they're not their fallen homes, they're not where they grew up, they're not with their family, and they're not on American soil until they're home. Thank you.
As you can see, these efforts to recover remains are very extensive, labor-intensive, a lot of logistics that go into them. Each one of these efforts is a major project within itself. How many people are there in the world today? How many are there going to be in 10 years, 25 years, 50 years? Population expansion is rampant across the earth. Many of the areas, especially from World War II, are being overtaken by urban sprawl, housing developments, resorts, other things, even the islands in the Pacific. They're covering over. One thing that you need to have to make a recovery is access to the soil that was on the surface at the time of the loss. A lot of that is being lost as they build buildings, resorts, and other things around the world. Time is of the essence. You heard that Congress has mandated 200 to be accounted for annually, and yet they are still only able to get to like 60 or 70. We need a major effort in accountability. We need to make the process more efficient. We need to speed the process and use advantage of our latest techniques and technologies. With that, I would like to introduce Mr. Ed Huffine, Vice President of Bodie Technology International Development, to talk to us about some of that.
Thank you very much. I'd also like to really thank Honor, Release, and Return, and Mo and Bob, and specifically for the honor of permitting me to address you today. I've been involved in missing persons identification for about 25 years now, and I've seen it evolve significantly. What I'm going to do today is go through very brief history and some examples of how the system that was initially developed to help identify the missing for the U.S. Armed Forces in the mid-90s transition into other countries to help them identify hundreds and thousands of their missing. Next slide, please. Back in the early to mid-90s, the state of DNA technology finally reached a level where it could be used to help identify missing persons. Now, this was originally used using mitochondrial DNA, and some of you may know what this is. Mitochondrial DNA is maternally inherited. So everyone in the same maternal line has the same mitochondrial sequence. And at the same time, people who don't even know they're related have a 5-7% chance of having the same mitochondrial sequence. It's very likely that everyone in this room would be able to find someone else with the same mitochondrial sequence as you have. So it's not unique to an individual. But in this particular case, what happens is you have other evidence that leads you to a presumption of identity. So you think you know who the individual is. You then use mitochondrial DNA to either say, yes, it's consistent with being this maternal line, or no, it is not. So it's used to help support what an initial lead in the identification is. Next slide, please. And one of the cases I worked on and oversaw was the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, Vietnam, Michael J. Blassie. And this is the press release live on the air in 1998 announcing it. And I remember that night before I was called by my boss and said, you're going on live national television, the Secretary of Defense tomorrow, don't screw it up. And I didn't have any gray hair before he told me that. As you can tell now, I have developed a little bit since then. Next slide, please. Next. I left the Armed Forces DNA Laboratory in 1999 to go to Bosnia because they had lost more than 100,000 people during the breakup of the former Yugoslavia. Next slide. Of that, approximately 20,000 were still missing. Next slide. Their accusation of genocide, you may remember the term ethnic cleansing. That's where this term was used widely. Next slide, please. And I went there in 1999 to begin a DNA project. Next slide. This is an example of a mass grave that had over 900 bodies in it. And when I went to Bosnia, I originally went there just to determine if DNA may be able to be used. And during my time there, I also was given the charge of the exhumation of mass graves, of working with family groups to develop an entire process. I was the third employee when I went over there. By the time I left, I was supervising 140 as this system began to evolve. But you see, in this particular case, the bodies are wrapped individually and laid out in a straight line. Next slide, please. And the war went on, the bodies were just dumped in mass graves. This is an example of a mass grave from Srebrenica. And if you remember your history, in July of 1995, about 8,000 boys and men went missing when the UN safe haven of Srebrenica was overrun. And many times, bodies were buried in a primary grave, then dug up with bulldozers, buried in a secondary mass grave. Those were dug up and moved to another grave. So you could have the same body having been in multiple mass graves as those mass graves were moved. Next slide. What we began to do is develop a forensic DNA system within Bosnia itself, and we trained scientists to do this that were Bosnian scientists, and we improved and developed a new way to get DNA from samples where you could get nuclear DNA. Now, if you remember, I said earlier, multiple people can have the same mitochondrial DNA. Unless you have an identical twin in this room, none of you have the same nuclear DNA. So nuclear DNA points to individuality. It's a very strong way to help identify individuals. Mitochondrial DNA needed supporting evidence. Nuclear DNA can stand alone in making identifications. Next slide, please. We also would go to families and collect reference samples from families who are missing loved ones. This is an example of a collection in Kosovo, where we would announce to this village, we're going to be here on these days. If you're missing loved ones, please come forward, donate a biological sample, and we'll take information about your missing loved one. Next slide, please. This is an example of, this is the mortuary in Tuzla, Bosnia. This is a picture of part of two rows, and there are many rows within this mortuary facility. There are 4,200 bodies in this facility. Over a 3-year period, 7 had been identified prior to the use of the DNA system, specifically nuclear DNA. Next slide. We developed the system, began to comparing profiles. What we did, we test every body that was found and exhumed. We would DNA test for nuclear DNA, put in a database. All the family relatives would test them for nuclear DNA, put them in a database, then ask the computer to cross-compare the two databases, bodies to families. When it found a match, we knew we probably had that individual. And I still remember that night, November 16th, 2001, when we were working on computers late at night in Sarajevo, and we got our first match to a 15-year-old boy who went missing in Srebrenica. This became a national day of remembrance for the missing in Bosnia. This is how important this event was. Next slide. So remember, all these bodies, 7 had been identified over a 3-year period. Next slide. Here are the coffins of the identified people. Nuclear DNA began to identify them, 100 per month, then 200 per month, then 300 per month, then 400 per month. So you saw a significant increase in the rate of identifications of the nuclear DNA-led system. It changed the role of DNA. DNA testing now led the process, and when we got a presumptive ID based on DNA, then the anthropologist, the pathologist would examine the body to make sure everything was consistent. If the family was missing John Doe, and you know that John Doe was a 25-year-old man who was 6 foot tall, who at one time had broken his left arm, everything should be consistent then with that body being John Doe. So it reversed the role of DNA and significantly increased the identification process. Next slide, please. Every July 11th, the bodies that have been identified for Srebrenica are returned to their families, and they're buried in a group burial in the Potocari Cemetery just outside of Srebrenica. Next slide. We always work with the families because the family groups are the most important groups in doing this. I have traveled the world in the last 15 years to more than 85 countries, helping many of them develop systems to identify their missing. When you talk to the family members, it's universal. Everyone wants their missing family member found, identified, and returned. This is common through all cultures across the world. This is a case, an example, of where we were briefing the family groups, and every month I would meet with the family groups. On the far right-hand side of this picture is Queen Noor from Jordan, And to her immediate right is Jim Kimsey, the founder of AOL. So this became very important and recognized importance by people across the world of the impact this new model, this Bosnian model, is having on the identification of the missing. Next slide. And this is an example of the families coming together to help encourage each other to participate. Both of these children are asking, where's my father? They're looking for their missing father. This, once again, is common. The search, the need to know. Next slide, please. So people ask, how can this now be applied in the context of the U.S. and the POW-MIA issue within the U.S.? This is an example of a case from earlier this year, Private First Class Gordon. Private First Class Gordon was a Canadian citizen who enlisted in the U.S. Army, was killed by the Germans in France, and buried in a German cemetery in France. So it was a little bit complicated situation just to begin. Next slide. He was killed in 1944. Next slide. There were inconsistent records. There were four sets of dental examinations. None of those four were the same. And none of them recognized he still had two baby teeth. But there was enough of a paper trail to be able to think, we know where this person is buried. Part of it was, in 1944, his mother received his wallet, which had his pictures in it. So it's obviously this came from him. So there was able to do some investigation to think of where this person might be. Next slide, please. Earlier this year, we received 0.15 grams of material to test. Usually want 2 grams, but we have 0.15 grams. Now for comparison, a nickel weighs about 5 grams. So this is less than 1/10 the mass of a nickel. Next slide, please. We're able to do both mitochondrial and STR testing successfully on these remains within 5 working days of receipt. Next slide. Only nephews were available for references. There weren't any children, any brothers or sisters or siblings, so we had to go to the next 2 generations out. Next slide. But we still got, with nuclear DNA, statistical match of 0.99995, which means it is almost certainly this person. Next slide. And he was buried in his hometown in August on the 70th anniversary of the date of his disappearance. Next slide. I just want to begin to summarize some of the lessons that we've learned from the Bosnian example, and other nations around the world are now adopting and utilizing the Bosnian model, which is a nuclear DNA-led system. Next point. The nuclear DNA-centric system, where all samples are initially tested for STRs, that's nuclear DNA, and it leads the process. The rate and the accuracy of identifications are significantly increased. Next point. Even a non-match has powerful exclusionary techniques. Next match. There's a far greater donor pool available for nuclear DNA than mitochondrial DNA or YSTRs. You can go to grandparents, grandchildren, go to nieces, to nephews. You have a much broader range of donors available. And for those cases that are so old that some of the immediate family members may no longer be available, this offers greater options. Next slide. This type of testing, nuclear DNA testing, does not depend on the accuracy of past records. If someone wrote something down wrong, if the dentition is wrong, if the height measurements were wrong, if the age guess estimates are wrong, it's independent of this. It simply matches a bone sample to a family reference sample. Because of that, it does not rely on past records, which may or may not be faulty. Next slide. It can also help to reassociate disarticulated remains. Since each person is unique, you can put their body parts back together. And we did this in Srebrenica in Bosnia, where it find an arm of a person in one mass grave, his leg in another mass grave, and his skull in another mass grave as they were being moved. And these are where the bodies able to be not only identified, but reassociated. Next slide, please. Today in Bosnia, if a mass grave is exhumed that has 100 plus bodies, About 85% of those bodies are identified and returned to their families within less than a 2-month period. So that is a very fast, very rapid way to do this DNA test to help identify the missing. And next slide. Next slide. And this is going to be my closing slide. This is an example of other countries coming asking for help. This was in 2005, where representatives from Guatemala, Peru, and Argentina came to Washington, D.C. asking, can you help us develop systems in our own nation to identify our missing from conflicts? Guatemala has tens of thousands of missing. Peru has thousands of missing. Argentina has about 8,000 missing. We help them set up systems in each of those countries based on the nuclear DNA system, and they're now identifying many of their missing. Even from back the 1970s, Argentinian Dirty Wars. They're identifying people today, and people are being held accountable today for crimes they committed in the mid-1970s. So this is a lot how the DNA science portion of this has evolved, and it's continuing to evolve. We're being able to make the next quantum leap. From a skeletal remaining in DNA doing DNA testing, we can tell, did this person have blonde hair? What was his eye color? What is his ethnicity? Was he Northern Scandinavian in ancestry? So all this is now becoming more and more powerful information to help in the identification of our missing. And all of this, everything you've seen today, is the direct result in the early to mid-1990s of what was done to help identify missing American service members. That science has gone around the world, it's evolved, it's adapted, and it's helping dozens of nations identify their missing. And I thank you for your time.
As you can see, government doesn't have to do it all. Partnering with private enterprise can make great advances into the future. Will our presenters please take your place? At this time, I'd like to again welcome back our good friend and Vietnam commemoration partner, Lieutenant General Mick Kicklider. He has presentations to make on behalf of the 50th commemoration. He will be assisted by Larry Brom and Colonel Deborah Graves. Come on, you did 2 miles this morning. Colonel Graves.
Good afternoon. At this time, and on behalf of a grateful nation and the Secretary of Defense and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the United States of America Vietnam War Commemoration is honored to present certificates of honor for immediate family members of those killed during the Vietnam War and are listed on the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington, D.C., immediate family members of those still unaccounted for from the Vietnam War and former prisoners of war from the Vietnam War. In May of 2013, during the Nam Pow reunion in Newport Beach, California, and subsequently last year during this event, we're very glad to be back, the commemoration presented certificates of honor to several of our former prisoners of war in attendance. And today, we are honored and privileged to present former POWs with their certificates and our new POW MIA pin. For those that have already received their certificates, they will just be presented the pin. The citation reads as follows. On behalf of a grateful nation and the Department of Defense, we honor your patriotic service and the significant sacrifices made by you and your family for the cause of freedom and democracy during the Vietnam War. Thank you for being an enduring inspiration an example of duty, valor, honor, and dignity for the citizens of the United States of America. Our nation is forever indebted to you and extends its deepest respect and admiration. Done this 19th day of September 2014, signed by the Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. General Kickleiter, sir. We would ask you to please stand if you're able to stand or raise your hand when your name is called. Commander Al Agnew, United States Navy, retired. A pen. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll ask you to hold your applause, and then at the very end, because there's quite a few. Master Sergeant David Alwine, United States Army, retired, pen. Captain William Akuri, United States Air Force, pen. Colonel William Austin, United States Air Force, retired, pen. Mr. Michael Benji, Department of State, civilian, certificate. Colonel Carly Harris, United States Air Force, retired, pen. Daniel Heffel, United States Army, pen. Staff Sergeant Nathan Henry, United States Army, retired, pen. Colonel Kieran Harlick, United States Army, retired, pen. Staff Sergeant Thomas Borio, United States Army, pen. Master Sergeant James Jackson, United States Army, retired, pen. As we move into position, let's give this group a round of applause. Colonel Stephen LaPole, United States Army, retired, certificate and pen. Master Sergeant Robert Lewis III, United States Army, retired, certificate and pen. Master Sergeant Isaiah McMillan, United States Army, retired, pen. Master Sergeant Major Cordine McMurray, United States Army, retired, pen. Captain Dale Rabel, United States Navy, retired, Penn. Major Mark Smith, United States Army, retired, certificate and pen. Mr. Larry Stark, Department of the Navy, civilian, certificate. Captain Ross Terry, United States Navy, retired, certificate, and pen. Colonel Jack Van Loan, United States Air Force, retired, Penn. Major Samuel Vaughn, United States Air Force, retired, Penn. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause. At this time, we'd like to present to Mrs. Laura Thompson, the daughter of Colonel Floyd James Thompson, the longest held American prisoner of war. We present you with this letter as we honor you and your family for your courage and your sacrifice. The next set of certificates of honor and pens are for immediate family members of the military of those still missing and unaccounted for. The citation reads as follows. On behalf of a grateful nation and the Department of Defense, we honor you for the significant sacrifice you and your family continue to make in the name of freedom and democracy over these many years. Thank you for your courage and for being an inspiration to the people of the United States of America. We renew our commitment to the fullest possible accounting for our patriots who have not returned. Our nation is indebted to you and extends its deepest respect and admiration, done on this 19th day of September 2014, signed by the Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Mrs. Doris Maitland, sister of Airman First Class Andre Gullett, United States Air Force, Penn. Frances Hicks, mother of Sergeant First Class Prentice W. Hicks, United States Army. Accepting the certificate for Mrs. Hicks today is Mr. Marshall Seeley. Certificate and pen. Ms. Teresa Ambrose, daughter of Command Master Sergeant Thomas Moore, United States Air Force, certificate and pen. Mr. Richard Watkins, brother of Chief Warrant Officer 2, Robert J. Watkins, United States Army, Penn. And at this time, we'd like to present Mrs. Patricia Blassie, sister of First Lieutenant Michael Blassie, whom received her certificate last year with her pen. Ladies and gentlemen, in closing, again, on behalf of a grateful nation and the Department of Defense, a special thank you to all the members of the Ride Home for the honor of presenting these certificates, letters, and pens to all of our veterans, but especially our Vietnam veterans, their family members, and to our former prisoners of war. Again, we appreciate your continued support, and indeed, it is the right time and the right place to recognize, thank, and honor all of our Vietnam veterans and their families. If I have missed anyone, I will stick around, so please let me know. Thank you, and join me again in a pleasant round of applause for all of our Vietnam veterans and their families.
At this time, we'd like to make our presentations to our guests on behalf of the Ride Home. I would like to reinforce to our recipients, you do not have to stand for this. You may remain seated. Okay, once we begin, this will be continuous, so we'll be rolling here. Our first recipient, Philip Allen, World War II. B.J. Carmichael, World War II. Edward Dement, World War II. John Robinson Dominey, World War II. William W. Jeffers, World War II. Erwin R. Johnson, World War II. Ralph E. Lamb, World War II. These are supposed to be ceremonial kisses, not passionate ones down here. Bernia Martin, World War II. Sam Mastrogiacomo, World War II. John L. Mims, World War II. Joseph C. Ortiz, World War II. Katie Sobeck, World War II. Leo Suter, World War II.
Sanford Walkie, World War II. Carmel Wetzel, World War II. William Benson, Korea. Bob Bostwick, Korea. Billy Brown, Korea. Newton Duke, Korea. Robert W. Fletcher, Korea. William D. Freeman, Korea. Emmett Harrison, Korea. Fred M. Liddell, Korea. Clyde P. Livaday, Korea. T.J. Martin, Korea. Dallas Mossman, Korea. William Norwood, Korea.
The kisses have begun again. Donald Peterson, Korea. Arden A. Rowley, Korea. Clarence Sadler, Korea. Ed Sheffield, Korea. Elliot Sortillo, Korea. Al Agnew, Vietnam. David Allwine, Jr., Vietnam. Bill Akuri, Vietnam. William Austin II, Vietnam. Michael Bang, Vietnam. Carlisle Smitty Harris, Vietnam. Dan Heffel, Vietnam. Nathan Henry, Vietnam. Quinn Herlick, Vietnam.
Thomas Horio, Vietnam. James E. Jackson, Vietnam. Stephen Leopold, Vietnam. Robert Lewis III, Vietnam. Isaiah McMillan, Vietnam. Cordine McMurray, Vietnam. Lou Meyer, Vietnam. Jim Pfister, Vietnam. Dave Rabel, Vietnam. Mark Smith, Vietnam. Larry Stark, Vietnam. Ross R. Terry, Vietnam. Jack Van Lone, Vietnam. Dick Vaughn, Vietnam. Joe Hudson, Gulf War. Can I have your attention go to the back row, please? World War II POW, Henry McGowan. World War II POW, Randall Edwards. World War II, Next of Kin, Timberlake, Meredith.
Paul M. Edzinger, Edheiser, excuse me, World War II. Joseph Carroll, World War II. Philip Kuhn, World War II. Luther William Davidson, World War II. Charles J. Lee, World War II. Robert Smith, World War II. William Vaught, World War II. Julian Walker, World War II. Teddy Weatherford, World War II. Kenneth Badke, Korea. Joseph Bramante, Korea. Floyd Campbell, Korea. Joseph Ford, Korea.
Carl M. Fox, Korea. Frank McNeely, Korea. Floris L. Pickett, Korea. James H. Ranciere, Korea. Donald R. Trudeau, Korea. Denny Young, Korea. And Floyd J. Thompson, Vietnam.
John Walter Lucas, World War II. Harry Tucker, World War II. Robert Amsden, Korea. Ernest Andrews, Korea. Roy Edward Barrow, Korea. Dudley Lewis Evans, Korea. William Grady Hill, Korea. Seth Jones Jr., Korea. Dwayne L. Murray, Korea. Lawrence Rafferty, Korea. James S. Streetman, Korea. Joseph Ichanas, Vietnam. Donald Grella, Vietnam.
Robert H. Zibb, Vietnam. Andre R. G.A., Vietnam. Prentice W. Hicks, Vietnam. Earl P. Hopper Jr., Vietnam. Bobby Jones, Vietnam. Thomas Moore, Vietnam. Kenneth L. Stansel, Vietnam. Robert J. Watkins, Jr., Vietnam.
Michael Blassie, Vietnam. John A. Franklin, Vietnam. Steve Lance, Vietnam. Michael Fortier. This concludes our awards at this time. Hold on. Do we have any mulligans? Okay, we're all good. Excellent. Let's give them all a big round of applause. Do we have one more? I see some hustle down there. Is there a...
James Sullivan?
James Sullivan.
Christopher J. Sullivan, Iraq.
My mistake. Christopher J. Sullivan, Iraq. That's what happens when you get your glasses from the VA.
Yeah. Okay. Would you like to come up?
Five Libby days, and I both married widows of ex-Vietnamese.
Okay.
And they're here, both of the wives here.
Okay.
I can't tell you that.
Do we know where, are they seated over here?
No, my wife's over here.
We have two other ladies here who are formerly married to POWs. Can you raise your hands, please? There they are, over here. Can we have some presenters? Sometimes we don't get everybody on the list, but we certainly don't want to not recognize everybody. Can I have the Light Horse Explorers come forward, please?
Clyde Labattis.
Mm-hmm. What war? Vietnam? Okay.
Is that the one you said is Liberty?
We have one of our last presentations there is Clyde Labattis. Labattis?
Korea.
Thank you. And the other?
Come back to the middle, Phil.
Yes, sir.
Was there another name that we needed to read? Mike?
Charles Newton, Korea.
Is there anyone else that needs to be recognized this morning? If not, thank you very much. Let's give them a round of applause. The Light Horse Explorers have a special presentation that they would like to make. So I'll turn it over to the Light Horse Explorers.
that we'd like to, Tyler, this is my father's great-great-nephew. He beat his hat for the World War II veteran. We'd like to present it. Also, they have a patch, their Life Force Explorer patch, Post 106, and also would like to have to present that to them. Tyler will go over and present your World War II veteran.
On behalf of the ride home, welcome home. Thank you all. Well, this concludes the formal part of our presentations and ceremonies this morning. After all that kissing, I'm sure some of you are hungry. We have lunch across the way. As always with our meals, our honored guests go first, and any escorts that are necessary, please feel free at this time to start moving across the hallway to the buffet lines that are on the other side of the hall.